So hi, I'm very glad to get this human-dominated ecosystems session started, and I'm filling in for Emma Rosie, who is the lead PI of the Baltimore Ecosystem Study. So in terms of site news, the Baltimore Ecosystem Study, or BES, is going to continue as a research project, but without LTER funding. There's a large group of scientists still interested in doing research together and has been out searching for alternative sources of funding. So we have an LTREB grant, which will continue a lot of the long-term watershed work, some terrestrial plot measurements, and our social survey data stream. The Forest Service has a large presence in Baltimore and funds a lot of research that's a part of BES. And we have a lot of investigators are sending in proposals to continue works aspects of BES. So BES is LTR funding for BES is ending, but BES itself continues. And I wanted to give three examples of human environment interactions work that's been going on over the last year or so. So one is some relationships between biophysical and social science. One of our great themes has always been integration between what people perceive, what they value, and how their perceptions and values influence their behaviors. A little work on emerging contaminants, work on pharmaceuticals in our streams, and then some long-term trends in nitrate and chloride in our ex-urban watershed. So we've done a social survey in Baltimore for the last 20 years, every 5 years or so, asking people their perceptions of the environment. And now we've had time to integrate that social survey with some biophysical data. And so one thing we find is that people have less perception of problems with air quality and less perceptions of problems with safety in area where canopy cover increases. So more green, less problems. For water, it's actually a somewhat different phenomenon in that in areas where there's more water nearby, more people seem to have increased perceptions of water quality as a problem. And these observations are detrended for socio-demographic factors. And this was a wonderful analysis led by a group of postdocs at BES. And it's just to me the kind of fundamental, in urban ecosystems, this idea of what do people perceive, what do they value, how do their perceptions and values influence their actions? And this is the kind of long-term basic science data that's super helpful for sorting that out. One of the real themes in BES has been emerging contaminants. But Emma Rosie's been leading this work for a long time. There are drugs in our urban streams. The Baltimore streams don't have any sewage treatment plants on them. And so if there's drugs in the streams, it comes from leaking sewage. And this is work that was led by Megan Fork, who was a postdoc in BES. And there's just a lot of drugs in streams. There's a lot of different kinds of drugs in streams. As the streams get more urban, there's more drugs and bigger, more drugs and more of the drugs in the urban streams. The real exciting thing about this work was doing a mass balance to make some calculations as to just how much of these pharmaceuticals were getting into streams. And the unit for the mass balance was doses of these different drugs. So tens of thousands of doses of antidepressants and painkillers and antibiotics are being delivered to Baltimore Harbor. And of course, this sets the platform for the real question with these emerging contaminants is, okay, we can detect them, but what are they doing? What are their effects on these ecosystems? And so this is really a platform for that. Are there a lot of kind of not depressed, not in pain crabs in Baltimore Harbor? We'll find out in the future. So another long-term challenge in LTRs is how are regional scale changes, things like climate and atmospheric deposition, how are they reflected in our local streams? And this is especially interesting in urban areas where there are lots of factors controlling the chemistry of streams. So we've been tracking salt for a long time, and it's warmer, there's less snow cover. There are real efforts to reduce road salt usage. We should see less salt in the streams, but boy, that's not the case. And we think we're looking at ex-urban streams where the density of the urban effect is quite a bit less, but there's just this inexorable rise in chloride levels in these ex-urban streams, even though it's warmer, even though there's less snow cover, even though the county is trying to use and the state trying to use less salt on the roads. For nitrogen, it's even more interesting because there have been remarkable declines in atmospheric deposition of nitrogen in the region. And you can see in the slide on the left in the forested watershed, there are real declines in nitrate concentrations in forested streams. We see it in Baltimore and we see it throughout the region because they're very sensitive to atmospheric deposition. So the question is, do we see that in our ex-urban streams? And no, we don't. So despite the fact that deposition has gone down, and despite the fact that the people are trying to use less fertilizer, we're still seeing this kind of inexorable rise in the nitrate concentrations, which are pretty high. They're a factor of 10 higher than they are in the forested streams. They're high, and they continue to go up. So in any case, these long-term data streams, again, provide a platform for these questions about long-term regional changes, and we'll be at it for another 20 years or so.